the expression from the music inspired me so much to take risks, and it inspired damn near the whole rap game.
Hello again, I'm Adam Unz. You may know me as the host of The Opus, and now I'm bringing my own show, The Spark Parade, to the Consequence Podcast Network. I speak with artists and creatives about the cultural artifacts that spark their personal interest and creativity, whether it's music, books, movies, video games, or any other kind of art.
I've never spoke about it in this amount of detail. I'm suddenly going, oh my God, I'm blowing my own mind here, Bryce. It's actually a giant part of my life.
By talking about the things we love, we share and discover insights into our personality and the things that drive us.
It's just magic, really. I mean, frustrating. And it made some people angry, but I don't think anyone's ever done anything like it.
I speak with people like Connor Oberst, Phoenix's Thomas Mars, Chris Gethard, Helen Hong, Adrian Young, and more, so their sparks of inspiration can start a fire in you.
I'm grateful for those who continue to put our history and who we are as a people in the forefront and make you see it.
Find the Spark Parade wherever you get your podcasts.
We all have that friend who wakes up early to go get everyone McDonald's breakfast, while the rest of us sleep in. This is your sign to thank them. And if you're that friend, this is us saying thank you.
Just a friendly reminder that right now, get any size iced coffee before 11 a.m. for just 99 cents. And a satisfying sausage McMuffin with egg is just $2.79. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
Consequence Podcast Network. Welcome to In Defense of Ska. We aim to push back on the mainstream's negative perception of the music. Ska deserves the respect genres like punk, hip-hop, and hardcore find among their listeners. Our host is renowned music journalist and author of the book In Defense of Ska, Aaron Carnes.
Today we bring on one of the biggest names of 90s third wave ska, Save Ferris' lead singer, Monique Powell. Though Save Ferris formed in 1995, a lot of the group's references are from the 80s, which was a very 90s thing to do, by the way. Their band name was a funny quote from the 1986 John Hughes film Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and the group's biggest single, Come On Eileen, was a ska-punk cover of the 1982 hit by the English Celtic rock band Dexys Midnight Runner. Save Ferris was part of Orange County's vibrant scene in the 90s and one of the few bands of their era that landed a popular song on radio. We talked to Monique about what it was like for her to be part of ska when it was at its commercial peak and what it was like to be part of ska when it stopped being popular. Though the band ended in 2003, she revived the group in 2013 and has kept it going ever since. Also, she tells us what it's like to persevere decades later. Save Ferris released an EP in 2017 called Checkered Past, and Save Ferris released a new song, Christmas Blue, in December of 2023, and more songs should be on the way soon. And joining me now is my co-host, veteran ska musician Adam Davis of Omnigon and Link 80.
When people talk about ska in the 90s, they act like there were so many bands playing ska on the radio.
Yeah.
Were there really that many?
I mean, what was there was Real Big Fish, Mighty Mighty Boss Tones, No Doubt came from the ska scene, Sublime. But, you know, one of those bands is Save Ferris. They're definitely part of that, like, clump of ska bands.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they're one of those bands that people who are not really part of the ska scene or don't really know a lot about ska, they remember that band. They remember Come On Eileen from the 90s.
Yeah, I would say a lot of people even probably know the Save Ferris version of that song better than the Dexys Midnight Runner version.
Yeah, actually, looking on Spotify and YouTube when I prepared for this interview, I would agree with you. Like, it's and actually, if you Google Come On Eileen, like, I think it has the Save Ferris version come up first.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't really realize it was, I mean, that was just my perception of it. I didn't realize it was actually, you know, how it is.
Yeah, yeah, no, it is. So, you know, I mean, when we talk about how ska has been defined in larger culture, I mean, we're talking about Save Ferris is one of those bands.
Yeah.
So, like, the nature of the bands, you know, a lot of them being like Save Ferris, kind of more like lighthearted OC ska type stuff, that has impacted people's view of ska, you know, even ska that doesn't sort of fit that mold. But I think that Save Ferris and these other bands are also impacted by sort of the pigeonholing that was brought on to them by it being sort of a very quickly kind of quick trend in the 90s thing, right?
Yeah.
Like it's hard for those bands to sort of move beyond how they were perceived in 1997.
Yeah. In having Monique on the show, we want to give a better context and depth to Save Ferris' story. And where better are you going to get it than with us ska scholars?
I want to start by talking about the latest or new song that you released in December.
Mm-hmm.
Christmas Blue.
I hear you say the past with us is through, but I'm afraid I may never get old.
This is the first Save Ferris studio recording that you've released since 2017, is that correct?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah, I just wanted to release a Christmas song to sort of start it off. I want to try and release a song and a video. I wanted to do it every month, but just because of the way the entire sort of ball rolls in the system, it's got to be every 6 weeks. So I'm trying to release a song and a video every 6 weeks this year. So I wanted to start it off with a Christmas song since I haven't really ever done an original Christmas song in Save Ferris.
Is this every 6 weeks new song? Are these going to be eventually an album or are these just standalone singles?
They're eventually going to be an album.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So let's talk about your Christmas song because it's a, would you describe the content of this? Someone maybe a little obsessed with their ex. Is that what we might say about it?
Yeah. Yeah. I wrote it about a friend of mine someone I knew that was just so totally obsessed with his ex-wife. Like even years later, it was like borderline stalking. And it really, I felt so bad for him that I just wrote this song. It made me really sad for him. wrote this song. Yeah. Sometimes you just want to shake him and be like, get over it.
I do appreciate a good Christmas song that's a little on the sad or darker side. Like I think Last Christmas by
Wham.
Yeah, Wham. Was it a Wham song? Or yeah.
It's a Wham song. Yeah.
It was a Wham song?
Yeah, okay. That's a sad song.
Yeah, it kind of is, right?
Yeah.
And the very next day you gave it away. Yeah. I gave you my heart and then you gave it away.
And then this year, yeah, given to someone special.
Yeah. That's a pretty sad song. Oh, Wham. They went from Club Tropicana drinks are free to like that.
Are you
never going to dance again?
Never.
That actually is George Michael though. But it was originally written as a Wham demo, I found out.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. It was like one of the first songs they wrote.
A plus for technical.
Yeah.
Well, I actually had heard I had heard Last Christmas was released as a Wham song, but he did all of that himself. Like he recorded all of it himself. So it's kind of technically a solo song, but it was a Wham release. So
all right. I take away the A plus for technical and I give it
an A minus.
An A minus.
Are these songs that you have coming out this year, are they all finished or are you sort of still working on them?
They're pretty much, well, let's just say I'm ahead of the curve.
Well, that's
good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I've got the next two songs already done. I definitely have the next video done.
Before we dive into some Save Ferris history, I want to ask, I heard that you had Gary Ullman officiate your wedding. So I got to ask about this.
Yeah. Like Gary's a friend. And yeah, very, very dear friend of my ex-husband and I, and we were, I mean, this was years ago, but we, you know, didn't want a religious wedding. And we thought, you know, what better person to officiate our wedding than someone who actually played both a rabbi and a priest in film.
So. Yeah.
I like that reasoning.
Yeah. And then he wasn't an Oscar winner yet. So
you know, he was just Gary at that time. No, I'm just kidding. he won the Oscar later. But
how did you end up becoming friends with Gary Oldman?
He was just a friend of my ex-husband's.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. They had been friends for a long time, and then through that, I became friends with him as well.
So. That seems like some most random factoid about you is Gary Oldman officiated your wedding.
Yeah, there's a lot of real randoms in my life.
That being one. Wait, give us at least one other one.
Oh my word!
we need another randoms in your life.
I can fit my entire fist in my mouth.
Do you have small hands or a big mouth?
Probably both.
Okay.
It's it's like a trick I've been able to do since I was a little girl, and I remember. You know, like I would hang out with my sister who's 11 years older than me, and I would hang out with her friends, her like teenage friends. And I would be like, you know, I was.
Oh, like, and then you're just like the spaz little sister.
I was like the little kid, you know. So she was like 15 and I was, 4 or 5, you know. And I would just stick my fist in my mouth and they would be like, whoa, she's super cool. And then I get to hang out with them all the time. I just feel a little kid hanging out with all the teenagers. It was pretty rad. And I just stick my fist in my mouth and do weird stuff and say weird shit. And they thought I was cool. So they let me hang out with them.
That rules.
Yeah.
So let's talk about an early Save Ferris song, Spam.
Yeah.
Tell me, I don't know how early this was. I know it was on your first EP as well as the debut record. But was there any specific inspiration behind this song?
I didn't write that song.
Oh no.
So I can't really say. But what I can say is that it's not my favorite song to play, but because people love it, I still play it.
Mm. Mm. It feels like one of those songs that like is like a fan favorite, but not a radio song type of thing.
Absolutely. That and Forever, that and Under 21, I call it Forever 21, that and Under 21 are two songs that I just like despise playing, but because the fans love them, I love playing them for them, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm like almost 50 years old. Like, why would I want to play a song about Spam or like a song called Under 21? Like, I'm not a child anymore, but
yeah,
they love those songs. So I love playing them for them. So,
when you perform a song like that, that you don't really have a deeper connection to, and you can kind of just sing the song, what do you think about when you're performing a song like that? Like what's going through your head?
I'm really, it's funny because, I remember who was it? It was a musician that I remember them saying that they were thinking about their grocery list sometimes when they were playing.
Sure.
Because like, you know, touring can get so repetitive. But for me, I'm so into the audience.
Yeah.
That, you know, I really just like to focus on what everybody's doing and how they're reacting and are they having a good time and stuff like that. That's really what I'm into, honestly, is that sort of exchange. Mm.
Do you ever have the issue where you're on stage and you can see everybody's having a great time, but you can see the one person standing who like maybe got dragged there by their significant other and they like just have their arms folded?
They're my favorite person. I swear to God, they're my favorite. Yes. They're the reason why I do what I do.
Yeah.
You know? Like they're the reason why, like they are my focus at that moment in time, because if I can win them over, then I've done my job.
Yeah.
You know, 'cause everybody else paid to be there. I know I've already won them over, but if I can get that one kid that whose like parent brought them that day, or vice versa, the one parent whose kid brought them that day.
Yeah.
They're kind of standing there. My favorite is like the boyfriend in the Cannibal Corpse shirt. My favorite. I'm like, dude, you're the cool. I will point them out and be like, you're the coolest person at this show. Like, and dude in the Cannibal Corpse shirt, always coolest person at the show.
Love it. Cannibal Corpse shirt at the Save Ferris show.
Before Save Ferris, you were in a band called The Shanties.
Oh yeah. The Shanties.
The Shanties. You want to talk about The Shanties?
Yeah. It was a very short lived all girls, traditional ska band, first wave. And, I don't remember too much about it. I just remember, the girls being really cool and me feeling like, wow, I don't belong. I don't belong in this band. These girls are way cooler than me. Just like the way they dressed and everything and their knowledge of music and their knowledge of ska. And I really learned a lot from them.
What was your, experience with traditional ska up to that point? Cause I know you were sort of exposed to ska in the Orange County scene, like Real Big Fish and those bands.
I was actually exposed earlier than that.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. As a kid, I was talking about my sister earlier. My exposure to music was really through her and her friends. Like, you know, I grew up with like, you know, Rude Boys and Punkers in the house, basically, coming to visit and Specials playing on the radio and, not so much first wave, but mostly second wave ska, lots of Madness, stuff like that, Specials. Yeah. So that's sort of my earliest exposure through in K-Rock Radio, when it was a pirate station, here in LA. My sister being like, I remember, you know, searching for the station on the radio with my sister and really just, yeah, listening to that in the early days.
Now, how much older was your sister than you?
11 years.
Oh, wow. So that's a big jump.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's my exposure to cool music. I attribute everything to her. Like, yeah. I take no credit.
Yeah.
You know, like my love of David Bowie, it's all because of her. She had a picture of him on the wall when I was a little kid and I was obsessed with that picture. And I remember hearing his albums for the first time when I was small and just being obsessed with everything she was into, I was into. I was obsessed with her, you know?
Aaron told me earlier it's David Bowie's birthday today.
It is. It's David Bowie, Stephen Hawking, and Elvis were all born today.
Wow.
Pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
Pretty big day.
That'd be a weird party to hang out at, too.
Just my kind of party to pass over a Quaalude at. Pass around a couple of Quaaludes.
When you and your sister are listening to the radio, are you taping stuff off the radio?
Oh my God, yes.
Yeah.
I had a pink, I'm just so dating myself. I had a pink ghetto blaster, like a little pink ghetto blaster, and I would tape everything on that. Yeah. Yeah. And then when my sister left, when I was 8, my sister moved away. So I inherited all of her records and all of her cassette tapes.
She just left it behind?
She had, yeah, she moved overseas. So she left that all behind for me. So like her Go-Go's records and her Devo records and all of it. Like just, I played them nonstop. Again, like, cause I was obsessed with her and I was just, I missed her so much. So yeah. I was like, I just played and to this day, those are just some of my fondest loves of music.
Do you remember how you ended up in the Shanties?
That's a good question. That I do not remember. I do not remember. I think through the scene, probably just hanging out and going to shows, probably.
So at this point, you're like going to shows a lot?
I was going to a lot of shows. Yeah.
Yeah.
All the time. And going to parties. Lots of, yeah. It was a scene. It was a scene. It was a really great scene.
Yeah. Orange County. So this is Orange County in the early mid-90s. Pretty vibrant for ska scene at this point, right?
It really was, particularly on all ages ska scene.
You had like several local bands, but how often were you getting touring bands all the time too?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, I remember seeing Selector. Who else? Yeah. I mean, I remember seeing the queers, but they're not, I mean, not too far away.
Mm-hmm.
Who else? Oh gosh. I'm trying to remember all the bands at these like all ages shows that would play, like touring bands. But anyway, I mean, I mostly remember the Selector and the Queers because those are really like monumental shows for me.
In Defense of Ska will return in a moment.
We all have that friend who wakes up early to go get everyone McDonald's breakfast while the rest of us sleep in. This is your sign to thank them. And if you're that friend, this is us saying thank you.
Just a friendly reminder that right now, get any size iced coffee before 11 a.m. for just 99 cents. And a satisfying sausage McMuffin with egg is just $2.79. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba. Hey, everybody, it's Barry from the What Podcast.
Hey, it's Russ.
Hey, it's Brian, and we are giving away two tickets to Bonnaroo 2024. These are GA+, and they include camping. Russ, how do people get qualified?
We want to hear your top artists to play on the Bonnaroo 2024 lineup.
Call 423-667-7877 and tell us who we should check out. It's the What Podcast. Thanks.
So going into Save Ferris, so you joined a band called Larry after the Shanties that sort of eventually led to you being in Save Ferris?
Yeah. Yeah. Larry was, so Ed from Suburban Rhythm, which is in a Real Big Fish song. Why did Ed and Scott quit? so Ed quit and then started Larry. And so, yeah. Oh, here's another weird factoid. Mm. The guitar player of Larry is Cliff from Finding Bigfoot.
What?
Yep. Cliff Berrickman from Finding Bigfoot was the guitar player in Larry.
Wow. That
swear
is
to God.
That is not something I expected to hear today.
Is I mean, we're covering it all.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Super weird, right? Told you, I have a lot of little.
Keep them coming. Yeah.
I'm going to blow your minds by the end of this interview. Guaranteed. Yeah. So Cliff and then Tim, who is the drummer for Death by Stereo. Eventually he went on to play. He was in One Eye Open, this band One Eye Open.
Yeah, I remember them.
Yeah. And Bob Easton, and Bob plays in Better Yeti. I forgot who he plays with now, but anyway, we were just a weird band, but because we were friends with everybody in the ska scene already, and I was dating, I think, at that point, was I already dating Matt Wong from Real Big Fish? So I was dating the bass player from Real Big Fish for like 4 years, Matt Wong. I don't know if I was dating Matt at that point or not. But because we kind of knew everybody in the scene, we just ended up being the band that like played with all the ska bands, but we were not a ska band.
I see.
What type of music was it?
It was just like weird Zappa influenced, like just weird. You want another weird? You want another? I'm gonna blow your mind. So we had a song called 4-pound bucket of lard and on St. Patrick's Day, we played in a roller skating rink. And I remember I had a cast on my foot and I wore like bright green tights over it and like this like green, like 1950s bathing suit with like a sheer sort of nighty over it. And the last song we did, we covered Rio by Duran Duran, mm-hmm. but in a really freaky way. Was it during Rio? No, it must have been during 4-pound bucket of lard, because at that point, Bob opened up a 4-pound bucket of lard and threw it at the audience.
Oh, no.
And everything was like slipping all over each other. And just like, it was just hysteria ensued. And we had the best time. Of course, there was a lot of drugs involved.
I'm trying to imagine.
He had dyed it green first. So he was within the spirit of St. Patrick's Day. So that, you know, ties it all together.
So just this green slime just all up in the audience, getting on everyone, everybody slipping in it, falling down.
Yeah. People were pissed.
It feels like lard would take some work to get off. Like you'd have to take a shower and just deeply scrub your body to get that off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were just, yeah, it was hilarious. I got out of there real, I limped out of there real fast. Limped out. Like I'm out. Clip, clop. I'm out.
How did you being in Larry lead to you being in Save Ferris?
I remember this band opening for us called Los Pantalones. And then one day I just got a phone call and it was some of the guys from that band. Mm. And I was like, oh, I remember you. And they said that they were starting a band calling it Save Ferris. And I was like, cool. I'll come and listen to some of the music. And they had a few songs already written. Spam was one of them. And I came out and listened to the songs. And, you know, like in Larry, I wasn't like a lead singer or a front person. And I really kind of, I wanted to be a lead singer or front person. And I wanted to be in a proper ska band because that's where my heart was at that time. And so, yeah, I met him and all the guys were really cool, nice, and yeah. And we set some ground rules. I was like, yeah, I want to manage the band till, you know, I can help us sort of get into a position to where we can, you know, be playing better shows and stuff. So I did.
So at that point, as you're joining the band, you're like, I understand how and what it takes to sort of move us from being a small band to like a band that's like actively working.
Yeah. I felt like I did. Yeah. Cause I had already been in the scene for a while at that point, and I knew a lot of people and a lot of promoters already. So I was very, let's just say I was young, but very, driven, I guess. Mm-hmm. Probably, I don't know, like at my age now, I don't know if that's something I would have done, but I did it. And I think I did okay.
You also record the co-lead vocals on She Has a Girlfriend Now by Real Big Fish. And she said she found someone who's gonna understand. She don't need nobody to be her man. She don't need nobody to be her man. Where does that factor in? Is it Save Ferris is already active at this point?
Actually, I don't believe so. Hmm. I think I recorded that possibly prior to being in Save Ferris, but that's a hard one. I can't really, the timing is probably so close. I was probably still in Larry. I can almost, yeah, you know what? I was still in Larry at that point because I remember rehearsing at, so we were rehearsing at Vince Pileggi's place, and that was Real Big Fish's old manager. he had a rehearsal spot, and Larry would rehearse there, and then Real Big Fish would rehearse like next door. And we were all really, really good friends. We're all close. And I remember Aaron asking me, he's like, do you want to do a song with me? And I was like, yeah, sure, dude, that sounds cool. So yeah, I believe it was before. And that was kind of like the first time I had ever done a real recording, now that I think about it. So yeah, it was before Save Ferris.
Oh, wow.
I think so. Yeah, that was the first time. And that was John Avila.
Yeah. Did you know that the guy from Oingo Boingo was behind the board when you were recording?
Yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, I went back to John to do the 2017 EP for St. Paris.
Time is a flat circle.
Yeah, full circle, my friend.
Do you remember anything about that, the recording of that song? Do you have any like memories that come up when you think about it?
I remember John being very positive and very kind. Yeah, I don't remember too much more about it. I mean, I think I must have been like 19 or something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's a long time ago. But I just remember feeling like, wow, this song's super cool, you know? That's kind of, and I was a little nervous. I just wanted to sound good.
The first Save Ferris EP, let's talk about this a little bit, because this is a self-released, I assume you guys went and paid for your own recording, that sort of situation. And you went and like sold it yourself, you know, out of your car or whatever, you know, just kind of hustling. Was this all happening really fast upon the formation of the band then?
It was, yeah. And my sister loaned us the money to record it. And I remember we could only afford like one 24-hour block. So we recorded in shifts through the night for 24 hours. So like while some of us were sleeping, others were recording.
Uh-huh.
And I remember it was recorded to tape.
Yeah.
To reel to reel.
Yeah.
And that was really fun. That's my favorite of all the Save Ferris stuff we've ever done. That's my favorite recording. I love that EP.
Do you remember what shift you took?
What shift? No, I mean, there were a number of different shifts that I took. Yeah, but it was really fun. And I love the way it sounds. I love the way it just sort of captures our youth. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Would you ever record that way again? Now?
I would.
Yeah.
I would. It's really time consuming, but yeah. Yeah. With someone who knew, you know, how to do it.
Oh yeah, of course.
Like who like really knew how to do it, not somebody who was kind of a novice at it, because it would take a long time.
Yeah.
So you started to get radio play on K-Rock from this EP, right?
We did. Yeah.
Do you know how that happened? Were you involved with that, or did a DJ just start playing it?
I don't know how that happened. I just know that there was a cassette tape going around with my phone number on it. It said for booking, call Monique, and it had my phone. And that somehow got to Rodney at K-Rock, and Rodney started playing it. I believe it was that cassette tape. It could have been that, or it could have been the CD. I don't know. Anyway, I don't know how it got to him, but it got to him, and that was pretty cool, because then he started playing us. And then from there, they added us. And when they added us, at that point, I was like, I can't do this. Like, I can't do this. You know, like half of the bands in Orange County already hated me at that point, because I was like, you know, I had to make some decisions for the band that I felt were important decisions for the band. And there was a lot of like sort of high school seniority, you know, unstated rules that were imposed by these boys that were like, you can't headline over us. We've been around longer than you. And I was like, I can't manage the band anymore. They already hate me. And I have to sing for this band, you know? So when we started getting played on K-Rock, I was like, yeah, we need a manager. Like, we need a real manager. I'm not a real manager, y'all. I can't do this. So because
even though you had song on a radio and you were developing a following, some of these bands saw you guys as like jumping the line, I guess, if you will, because they were around longer than you.
Totally. Oh my God, yeah. And it was sad because I always saw all of us as like a group and a unit and sort of a scene. Like, we were all doing this together, but unfortunately when that happens, when you sort of move ahead in the line, other people feel like they're being left behind. You know?
Yeah.
And they don't like it.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
You then get signed to Epic. So the Epic signing, it's related to like a Grammy Award showcase that you played?
Yeah. So our new manager entered us into this Grammy contest that it was funded by the NARIS Foundation, which is the Grammy Foundation, the National Association of Recording Arts and Sciences. So they were doing this Best Unsigned Band in America contest.
Mm.
And yeah, and so we entered into it. And I think the first contest, you performed at the Whiskey, and then something like that. And then if you won that one, then they flew you to New York. And you played it, and we played it, and we won that. And then we flew to Irving Plaza. And then we played at Irving Plaza in New York, and we won. We won that. We won the Best Unsigned Band in America. And one of the judges was David Massey, who is an A&R person for Epic Records, and he signed us on the spot.
Wow. I was reading that there was something like, I don't know, 6,000 bands that submitted to be part of this contest, I guess.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
That must have felt pretty good to not only win this contest, but then to get signed.
Totally. That was like, you know, when you're a kid in those days, that was everything. That meant everything, to get signed to a major label. And like, yeah. We did the whole thing. Like, we were wined and dined and taken to the nice restaurants and flown around and put up in nice hotels and all of that. So we got the full treatment.
So, okay, you're working on the record. Come On Eileen. Now, this was your suggestion, right? To say we're going to cover Come On Eileen for the record?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know if I said we were going to do it for the record. I just remember saying I wanted to play that song.
Yeah.
And so I just really wanted to play it live because I love that song.
Was that one that you'd been introduced to by your sister?
Absolutely. Yep.
Love that.
I was thinking about how, like, you know, a lot of us who were kids, you know, young adults in the 90s, pop culture had a lot of like 80s references to it, you know, whether it's like bands like yourself covering 80s songs or like the movie Wedding Singer, I thought was like a good example. But I think a lot of it's because people like us, like I have a brother who's 7 years older, like our older brothers and sisters were like exposing us to 80s pop culture when we were kids. So like we kind of went into our teenage and early 20 years obsessed with the 80s a little bit.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, that's why I love John Hughes films.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's your favorite one?
Maybe 16 Candles.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good choice.
That's a John Hughes film, right? I haven't watched them in so long. I just remember being sort of obsessed when I was a kid.
Now, did Come On Eileen, was that a hit quickly? Did that blow up pretty fast?
It did, yeah.
That's kind of how I remember it, but I'm not like 100% sure.
Yeah, it did.
Did the single get released like right, was it before the record or right when the record came out?
Yeah, it was right when the record came out or right before the record came out. It was, they had like, you know, the whole plan with the record label, the way that they would release singles and albums was very pre-planned, you know? So it was like, release the single, then release the album however many weeks later, and then all of that.
Yeah, that was right. And that was in 97 too. And I think that was a pretty prime moment for ska being on the radio and ska being on MTV.
Mm-hmm.
It was, yeah.
Yeah. Were you surprised at how big that song got?
I was surprised, but I was also very happy about it.
Sure, yeah. What were the other songs, the other singles on the record?
So it was Goodbye.
Yeah. Oh, and The World is New.
World is New, yeah, that's it.
Do you remember, I'm trying to remember how those songs did. Like, I remember them. And I'm looking on YouTube now and they both have gotten a ton of views, but I don't remember in the 90s how they did.
World is New did pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
World is New did really well, actually. And then we moved on to the next record pretty much after that.
So Goodbye didn't really do well as a single per se?
I don't know if they really pushed it that much, to be honest. I know that we just like, really, really toured a lot behind those two singles, World is New and Come On Eileen. And then I think that they sort of tried with Goodbye, but I don't know if they really put a lot of push behind it because we ended up doing the next record.
So I was reading an interview you did in 98 and you're talking about how you have an onstage persona and that it's a character.
Yeah.
So this is what you said in 98. You said, I love her. She's exciting and energetic and everything I feel on the inside when I'm walking to the supermarket in my pajamas. I could do it without the makeup and hair, but it wouldn't be the same for me. So I'm kind of curious if you want to like talk a little bit about, you know, back then what it was like and what this character was and how that maybe has changed or hasn't changed.
Oh, I like that. The character's definitely more developed now.
Mm.
When I was younger, I don't think that I had the like life experience to be able to develop this character fully. I knew, like, I had an idea of what I wanted it to be like. But I just don't think I had enough self-awareness to be able to fully project that person, you know, but I did my best to try and be, you know, the outspoken, very sure of herself, all of the things that like I wanted to be, It's hard to explain. Like it was a character I created because I was very insecure. I was really innately very insecure, and the industry was not very supportive of me or women in general at that time, and so I had to create this character. My sister would always say to me, Monique, because I would say I'm so scared, you know, and I feel so alone all the time. And she would say, just act as if you're the person that you want to be. So I created this character that was brash and outspoken and very sure of herself and loved herself. And through acting as if I sort of grew to like myself more and more as the years went on. Mm. And yeah, and we've kind of merged. The character and I have merged. And so, yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah. Now she's like, I feel like it's a more developed character now because I am more self-aware and I'm older and I have more life experience. So it's more true.
We'll be right back after this.
Hey, everybody, it's Barry from the What Podcast.
Hey, it's Russ.
Hey, it's Brian, and we are giving away two tickets to Bonnaroo 2024. These are GA+, and they include camping. Russ, how do people get qualified?
We want to hear your top artists to play on the Bonnaroo 2024 lineup.
Call 423-667-7877 and tell us who we should check out. It's the What Podcast. Thanks.
Oh, so I want to talk about one other thing that was that another big moment of pop culture was you were on in the film 10 Things I Hate About You.
Yeah.
So this was happening at the height of you guys touring all the time. Mm-hmm. And so you're on tour, right? You're on tour, on Warped Tour, and you got a call to come film this scene. Mm-hmm. Is that how you remember it happening?
That's how I remember it happening. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember. Yeah. I think I remember that, yes, being that way. And then it was sort of like we had like a day off, one day off to fly to Seattle, I think it was, to film this prom scene for this new movie. And I had never done anything like that before. I had no idea what to expect. So I just showed up and I was like, just tell me what to wear and where to go. And yeah, we showed up and it was cool. And there was this, you know, new actor everybody was talking about named Heath Ledger.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there was like this buzz around him already. It was really interesting. And he was really nice. Everybody was very nice.
Yeah, that movie did really well, and I feel like it's still something that people are interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Like especially if it's like, oh, you know, some of my favorite movies from the 90s, and then that movie comes up frequently.
Yeah, it's interesting. I remember the director saying that he wanted it to be a 90s John Hughes film.
Mm, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, that fits.
Yeah, and so it's sort of, I think it ended up like that for kids of the next generation. So like what the John Hughes films were for us, that film was for them. And so, yeah, we can go anywhere in the world and, you know, they don't speak English, but as soon as I say 10 Things I Hate About You, they freak out because they know that film, you know, that's pretty cool.
Is that the thing that you feel like you maybe get recognized the most from, or like Come on Eileen? I'm just curious.
Probably Come on Eileen. Yeah, probably Come on Eileen.
Did you feel like you were legitimately famous for like this period of time that this is all happening?
Not really. Not really. I mean, like living in Orange County, yeah, I mean, totally recognized and all of that. But living in Los Angeles, not so much. And I was much more comfortable with that, to be honest.
Is that because in Orange County, you know, Orange County ska is such a bigger thing, but in LA there's like actors everywhere and whatnot, and everybody's trying to not act starstruck.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Can you think back to this period and just various sort of promotional things or just weird, like, oh, because we want you to do this MTV event or whatever, anything come to your mind as kind of an odd little promotional late 90s sort of thing that you did during this period?
God, Japan was always weird. Like they always had us doing weird stuff in Japan.
Like what?
Well, I remember doing a TV commercial for a car, and it was all like bouncing on, what do you call it? On, you know, you have them in your backyard.
Oh, trampoline.
Yeah, trampolines. So we were like literally flying, bouncing on trampolines, which was so exhausting and super weird. And at one point, I could be wrong, but I think that they had someone in a harness flying somewhere. And that was kind of weird. I don't think it was me, but there was that. There was like a Japanese game show where Bill, the bass player, who's Japanese but doesn't speak Japanese, which they were super weirded out by that, like that he looked Japanese but didn't speak Japanese. And the show was, it was weird. It was like they'd have people of different nationalities come on, and they would yell a phrase in Japanese at us, and then we would have to repeat it in Japanese to them, right? So, and it would be absolutely, you know, terribly wrong, and then everybody would laugh at us. And poor Bill, like, I went out there, and they yelled something at me, and I was like, dude, this sucks. I am not doing this. Bye. And then Bill went out there, and everybody, it was so sad, and everybody just laughed at him, and he was just such a good sport. But that was super weird. Yeah. They just yell something in Japanese, like, I don't know. Ichi ni san chi. And then you have to yell it back at them, and you'd say, he'd be like, Ichi ni san chi. And they'd be like, ha, 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 ha. You are terrible at our language. Ha, ha. You Americans. Ah. And there was, and I remember being like this like famous like Russian or German wrestler who came out too. And yeah, it was really, it was very sad.
I mean, I could see how that would be embarrassing at the time, but looking back on it, that sounds like a fun show.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Totally. It's like, embarrass the Americans. Yay!
Now, so I'm curious if you remember what it was like going into, you have a next record on the menu. It's modified. It's 1999 when that comes out. You'd had the success with the first record. What was your guys' thought process? Was there expectations from the label? Where was your spirit at, I guess, when you go into this?
Well, our spirit was like, you know, we got to keep up with the times, and times were changing. Mm-hmm. And we also didn't want to be pigeonholed. And the label was urging us to write songs that were, you know, ska influenced, but less horn heavy, and some mm-hmm. songs without horns. And, you know, I remember writing a song for the album that didn't have horns on it. And one of the horn players threatened to quit the band if we recorded it. So we recorded it, and then they made it the secret track. Coincidentally, it was the title track of the album, which became the title track of Modify, which became the secret track on Modify, but it was the title track, which was so super weird. But can you see? But, you know, it was us desperately trying to stay relevant, you know? And there's some really good songs on that album.
Yeah.
Really
yeah.
good songs. But you know, like what always happens at labels is, there's shifts in administration, mm-hmm. you know, heads of A&R change, presidents change, and they clean house when they come in, and they think that they're going to get rid of bands and sign different bands, and they're going to do a complete overhaul. And we had been gearing up to record a video, and we were touring, and just, we had all of these things planned for this album. And unfortunately, you know, Epic got a new president, and she, I think her name was Polly Anthony. Polly Anthony didn't like us, so she let us go.
Not a ska fan.
Not a ska fan. No, not a ska fan. But, you know, we were kids, you know, and like, we didn't know what we were doing. We really needed guidance. I don't feel like we had what we needed to be able to sustain. We didn't have that one voice of reason, be it a manager or an A&R person or, you know, a person in the band. I didn't have the knowledge, you know, I didn't know what I was doing. So we just didn't have that one person, that one voice that was like, you know what, you guys, this is the direction you need to go into. And, or you should write like this, or a co-writer, maybe an outside co-writer or something like that. We just didn't have that. So that's it. We were no longer signed.
If you from 2024 went back into time, how would you advise Save Ferris of this time period?
I think I would have gotten different management. To be honest, I think the management we had at the beginning was good, but for that time. But then once we had gotten signed, we needed better management. I think we needed more of a team of managers to be able to, you know, work not only with the band and keeping the band together and moving smoothly and communicating productively, but also being able to work with the label and communicate between the band and the label and all of that. And someone who had more experience maybe and more connections. But it's, I mean, I don't know if anybody was like breaking down the door to manage us, you know. I'll be honest, I don't know. Who knows? So I think I would have done that. I think better management. And also I think I would have been a better communicator. I didn't know how to communicate very well. I was so closed up, you know, and afraid of everything, so scared of everything. I was just afraid of like making everybody mad at me all the time. I was just afraid to talk about anything ever with anybody. And so there wasn't a lot of communication going on. So my needs were never met because I was never asking for what I needed.
I mean, it must be so weird to be that young and having to deal with that level of success.
It was truly, truly, truly. But I don't know if anybody at that age is truly prepared. And I'll be honest, I think that that's why labels sign bands so young, because part of the reason is that they just don't know any better. So you slap down this 200-page contract in front of them and they're just, they have stars in their eyes. They're like, we're going to get signed. We'll sign anything. Mm-hmm. This is awesome. You know, and we'll say yes to anything at this point. Because we don't know. They don't know any better. You know, we'll tour nonstop for years and years and years to pay our manager, make sure our manager gets paid, you know, but at the detriment of our health and our mental well-being and all of that.
It's psychotic that all this is still the same, that labels still, you know, go through these upheavals every couple months where they clean house.
Yeah.
And that young bands just continually grind until they burn themselves out.
Yeah, the problem is that labels don't sign people for like $1.9 million, like what Save Ferris was signed for. They sign people for like $25,000 and now you're not like signing your life away for something, you know, kind of worth it. Like now you're signing your life away for like not worth it. Yeah. So that's also a problem.
Yep.
So in the 2003, I want to ask about a specific show. You played Bottom of the Hill in 2003.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell people about the show and what happened? Your voice
if you know what's about to happen.
Do you want to tell people what happened while you were on stage performing at Bottom of the Hill?
Yeah. So Save Ferris was playing Bottom of the Hill in 2003. And about the third song in, our manager at the time comes up and while I'm playing, I'm like, what are you doing up here? Comes up and whispers in my ear, don't freak out. This is, I quote, don't freak out. Now, wait, hold on. Let me set the stage. Probably about a week prior, there was a huge fire and a bunch of people died at a Great White show.
Mm, yeah, I remember that. Right. Yeah.
Remember that show? Where was it? Rhode Island? Where was it? I can't remember, but it was all over the news and I was horrified. So like a week or so later, manager comes up and he says, don't freak out, but there's a fire in the venue and you need to stop the show and clear this place out. And my heart stopped. But but when I had seen on the news all the press about this Great White show and what a tragedy it was, I remember thinking to myself, if that were me, I would not leave until the last person was out the door.
Yeah.
Because if somebody died at my show, I don't think I'd be able to live, and be honest. Mm-hmm. So I stopped the show and I was very calm. And I said, okay, everybody, there's a fire upstairs. So we're going to very, very, very quietly exit the venue very peacefully. Okay, here we go. And I remember kind of stepping off the stage and sort of, you know, pointing everybody out the door. And it was such a calm environment that people were asking me for my autograph while we were in the venue. And I was like, and they were like trying to buy merch. And I'm like, no, 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 no.
Let me grab one of them shirts first.
There's a fire. There's a fire. Yeah. And as we walked outside, we saw the place just sort of, you know, become engulfed in flames. And people were, I mean, everybody was happy that they got out alive, obviously. And they just wanted pictures with me in front of it. So like, is this appropriate? I don't know.
Have you seen any of those photos?
I have. They're hilarious.
Oh, man.
They're fucking hilarious. Oh, my God. They're so funny. I may even have one somewhere. I don't ask me to find it because I don't know if I'd be able to, but
hopefully somebody will send us one.
Oh God, I pray someone sends you one.
Send us one, please.
Have you been back to Bottom of the Hill since?
I think I have been, actually. And I remember telling the story about that.
Nice.
Yeah.
So this is the upstairs, the like backstage area. This is what we're talking about, right?
No, there's apartments upstairs.
Okay.
And so that caught fire.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. There was a fire up there and then the fire started to sort of engulf the dressing rooms and stuff like that. Fortunately, none of the equipment caught fire or anything like that.
Yeah. And if I understand correctly about Bottom of the Hill, they do have some soundproofing in there for the people upstairs. But I also feel like some of the people who live up there maybe are deaf. Maybe like that just seems like the best option. Although I did meet somebody going up there once and they were definitely not deaf.
My God.
And they also, I asked them, I was like, hey, what's it like living above Bottom of the Hill? And they're like, I like it. You know, every now and again, I'll hear something I really like and I'll just pop down.
Oh, that's amazing. You know, I would think if I owned that building, I would give first right of rental to the people that worked there.
Yeah.
And I would also give like free tickets for the lifetime of you living in that apartment.
Yeah. Any show, you just walk down.
Yeah.
Come right in. Yeah.
Lifetime free tickets as long as you're living there. I would live there. Shoot.
Dude, hell yeah.
Amazing. I love it.
That neighborhood has actually come up like a lot too in recent years. Like it's nice down there now.
Wow.
There's a Whole Foods, like walking distance.
Dang. You know, if there's a Whole Foods, it's going to be nice.
there's a nice art supply store. There's all sorts of good stuff.
Dang. Yeah. You know, the minute they build a Trader Joe's too. Woo.
Yep.
I remember like speaking of, you know, music venues, in the 80s, this story just comes up. I don't know why I'm telling it to you, but in the 80s. So was it in the 80s? So it was early 90s. My sister was living in New York and my parents and I went to go visit her and she lived on 3rd and 3rd right outside CBGB's. And I remember visiting her in her apartment and you could not only see CBGB's from her window, but you could hear the bands playing every night.
Damn.
And that was the coolest thing ever. It was so dope.
In the 80s too. So there's cool bands playing.
Yeah. It was like late 80s, early 90s, probably early 90s. Yeah. So dope.
did Save Ferris ever play at CB's?
No.
Okay.
I wish.
Yeah.
But no.
In Defense of Ska will return in a moment.
Hey, everybody, it's Barry from the What Podcast.
Hey, it's Russ.
Hey, it's Brian, and we are giving away two tickets to Bonnaroo 2024. These are GA+, and they include camping. Russ, how do people get qualified?
We want to hear your top artists to play on the Bonnaroo 2024 lineup.
Call 423-667-7877 and tell us who we should check out. It's the What Podcast. Thanks.
So the band, I guess, basically breaks up that same year, 2003?
Yeah. So we had sort of like this mass exodus in 2001.
2001. Okay.
Yeah. And then I continued on with some other players until 2003. And then sort of just decided I needed to take a break for a little bit after that. So I did.
Yeah, so this break ends up being 10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to talk about what went into you reforming the band, because it has to do with your neck and spine injury and you getting surgery for that, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so part of the reason why I just couldn't play for 10 years was because I had this injury that made it like close to impossible for me to be able to perform.
Was this an injury like wear and tear sort of thing, or did you have like an accident?
We don't know ultimately, like do I have this like degenerative condition that I inherited? Was it an accident when I was a little girl, maybe, that I don't remember having something fallen on me or gotten into like an injury in a car accident when I was small? Or was it wear and tear from being on the road all those years? We really don't know. But basically, you know, like I didn't have health insurance for a number of years. So I just sort of dealt with the pain. And then when I got married, I got really good health insurance. And I decided to finally see a doctor and get an MRI. And the diagnosis was not very good. It was very bad. I've been walking around on a broken neck for years.
Jeez. When do you feel like you thought to yourself, oh, there's something going on with my neck. Maybe it's, you know, maybe I need to see a chiropractor. When did you just get an idea that maybe there was some issue in that region?
Well, You know, like not having health insurance, I tried every other option, like acupuncture, chiropractic, all of that. What I didn't know was that chiropractic was could virtually paralyze me. Not virtually, but literally could paralyze me. So chiropractic was a bad idea, but that was something that I was doing and not knowing how dangerous it was. Geez.
Yeah.
So I was trying everything.
Was this just during the 10-year period, or were you was it during the band's run, the initial run where you were like starting to worry about your neck?
During the band's run, I had thrown my back out a couple times. In which it was like, I don't know if I can go on stage, but then I would do it anyway, you know? And then I would be like down for the count for like 3 days at a time and just have to get myself up and just go and do it anyway.
Oof.
Well, that was really hard.
But I at the time you probably just assumed my back's out of alignment or whatever. It's not a major issue, right? I mean, when you were in the band, you probably assumed it was something like that, not like I have a serious, serious condition.
Yeah. Well, I mean, not to talk about my health issues too much, but, you know, my lower back was also an issue. And I honestly just thought like, oh, I have like some injuries and I have some arthritis that's kind of bad and it just flares up, you know?
Yeah.
And it flares up kind of bad, or maybe I have a disc protrusion or something like that. So when I went to Cedars and I saw this, you know, the head of the spine department, and got the, imaging done, he came in and I remember him pulling up some imaging on the computer and he was like, oh, hi. Okay. Yeah. And da, 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 da. How old are you? I told him how old I was at the time. How old was I? I don't know. I wasn't even 40 yet. Was I? I can't remember how old I was. 2013. Wow. That was already like 11 years ago. Wow. So, I wasn't even 40 yet. So, hey, how old are you? Blah, blah, blah. He says, hold on a second. And he calls the nurse. He says, nurse, I need Monique Powell's imaging. And the nurse looks at it and says, that is her imaging. And he says, no, 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 it's not. And she says, yeah, yeah, it is. And he looks at it and goes, oh. And later on, he told me he thought that it was the imaging of an 85-year-old woman.
Jesus.
He did not think that it was the imaging of a woman my age because there was so much degeneration in my neck. I was like, hey, so what's the problem with my lower back? I really thought that the issue was going to be my lower back. I just thought that I had, you know, I didn't know that my neck was going to be such an issue, but because I was having problems walking, like I was having problems on the right side of my body, like holding a fork and I was kind of tripping and stuff like that. I was losing, mobility on the right side of my body. And so when they did all these tests, they found that there was some spinal cord damage, which is irreparable.
Wow.
So at that point, he's like, we need to operate now. If you were to be jostled in the wrong way, you could become paralyzed. You may not be able to walk anymore. But the problem is that this surgery, we go through the front of your neck and you may never be able to sing again because they have to move over the voice box and the vocal cords and everything to get to, because it's less dangerous to go through the front. It's really, really risky to go through the back because of the positioning of the spinal cord. They don't want to deal with it ever. They don't have to. So he said to me, you know, go and get some more opinions, please. Go and get some more opinions. So I did. And everybody had the same opinion. You need surgery now. This is urgent. And we got to go through the front and you may never be able to sing again. And that was very hard. So finally I went back to that first doctor and he actually called me. He called me from the car one day. He said, listen, I'm going to get together with a team of doctors, neurologists, neurosurgeons, orthopedics, other orthopedic surgeons in my department. And we're going to go through the back of your neck. We're going to figure this out. And they did. Yeah. So, and it was kind of a miracle. Like, because nobody knew if like I would be able to walk after the surgery or if I would still be able to sing. It was sort of like, all right, let's do it and let's see if it works kind of thing.
Did you have any reservation? I mean, obviously they were saying this is a, life-saving, albeit risky, but did you have reservation about doing it because of the risk?
Yeah. I mean, of course, but I knew I had to do it. And like right before, for like 10 years, my dad was a singer. So my dad was a singer my whole life. That's why I started singing. And for like 10 years, my dad would say, Monique, when are you going to get back on stage again? When you get back on stage again? I was like, Dad, I don't know. And at one point I thought I may never get back on stage again, So I remember right before I went under, I said to my dad, Dad, if I wake up from this and if I can still dance and if I can still sing, then I'm going to bring the band back. And so after I was in ICU for like 12 hours after because something with my heart rate was irregular. They couldn't get it normalized. But after I got out of ICU, that night, like they have you stand, and you can't wear a neck brace. You have to be able to raise your neck yourself. So they can see if the body, if you can walk, if you can stand, and man, it was painful. I just remember like the pain was so great. I was throwing up from it, but I could stand. And at that point, they were like, it was a success. And I just remember laying down and going, fuck, I got to bring the band back. I promised my dad I would. So I did, I brought the band back and then, but it took, 4 months of really intensive, physical therapy to learn how to hold my head up on my own. And, because they had to cut through this big muscle on the back of my neck. And I also had a series of like epidural injections in my lower back, cause I have two discs that are burst down there. And so there was a lot of physical therapy that went into just learning how to sort of walk and hold my head up and be able to raise my arms again. There's a lot of like, it's weird. You don't realize like how heavy your head is until you don't have that muscle anymore and how many muscles are connected to that big muscle in the back of your neck. So like 4 intensive months of physical therapy. And what's interesting is that, I brought the band back, my dad got to see me on stage again, and then we recorded that EP and my dad got to sing on it. He got to sing on Goodbye Brother on that EP. And then like probably not long after we released it, like maybe a week after the release, he died.
Wow.
So it was kind of all happened in perfect timing,
Yeah. I've seen footage of, Save Ferris in this, this chapter of the band. You seem like you're totally fine to dance and sing and everything. Are you managing pain or are you at a place where you feel okay to do all this activity?
The surgery was definitely a success. The the injections were successful. I've been relatively pain-free, only because the pain is in no way comparable to where I was at before the surgery, you know? Yeah. So yes, I've had some issues. Yes, I do still have some issues, but no, there is no comparison to where it was before. So, but you know, I'm careful as well. I don't ever want to go back to that place.
Mm-hmm. When you say you're careful, do you mean stuff like stretches, like amounts of shows you choose to do in a given period of time?
Yeah, stretching, but also how I move. I'm careful with how I move, any sort of jerky motions and head banging, stuff like that's out of the question now. Ain't happening.
So we don't have to go into detail, but can we kind of just get the cliff notes of the fact that there was like an issue with some of the old members of the band and kind of that it happened and then got resolved and now you're the legal owner of Save Ferris?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how much I can say about it, but
yeah, just whatever you feel like, just to summarize, just so people understand sort of the story of what happened at this point.
Yeah. I mean, to summarize, I wanted to bring the band back. A representative for them was approached to play with me. Rather than them respond, they pretended like they weren't approached. Mm-hmm. There is some debate there whether or not they were ever approached. They put out a statement claiming that they were never approached. And then they sued me. Mm-hmm. And when they sued me, I mean, I had no choice. I had to countersue. Mm-hmm. And by countersuing, there had to be a resolve and a settlement. And in that settlement, they had to release any ownership of the name. So that's basically what happened. Now I'm the sole owner.
What year did it officially get resolved? Do you remember?
Was that 2015, I think.
Okay.
I think that was 2015.
Okay. So I want to ask you about a thing. And so in 2018, so Save Ferris did like some sort of like residency at Harrah's in Vegas.
Yeah.
But it wasn't like a typical show, right? It was like sort of a theatrical sort of show, right?
Kind of, yeah. It was like I wanted to turn it into more of a Vegas-y show.
Yeah. So what did you do? How did you do that?
It was called the Save Ferris Show Show.
The Save Ferris Show Show.
It wasn't just a show. It was a show show. It was kind of scripted. There was a little bit of comedy and, it was a little bit more theatrical, like you said. Yeah, that's about it. Like I worked with a comedy writer and it sort of launched this show that I've been writing, more of a solo show that I've been writing for Vegas. And right before COVID, we were set to launch this show in Vegas and then COVID happened and our venue closed down. It was at Caesar's Palace. But it's still going to happen. It's just a matter of timing right now and venue. But it's like a variety show.
Nice.
Yeah.
Is there any ska in it?
No ska. There's no ska, but it's a show for adults, for grown-ups, but for us, for our scene. So ska kids from our generation would really like it. Yeah.
How long did the initial Save Ferris residency at Harrah's last for?
Was that like a month-long residency or 2 months? Maybe it was like a 2-month-long residency, something like that. It was cool. It was really cool to see the growth of playing a place at a regular time, weekly.
Yeah.
And seeing crowds sort of establish around that. It was kind of neat building an audience around a regular show. I liked it.
Very cool. Okay, so last question I want to ask for the interview was, what does ska now more than ever mean to you?
Well, you know, that was, so Patrick Ferguson, who was playing with us a few years ago, came up with that saying.
Mm-hmm.
And it was when we were experiencing a lot of icky stuff in this world, a lot of hardship. And it's just like, you know, through our shows, I feel that I've been able to bring a sense of happiness to people that like, that they deserve, you know, and through the music, we're able to bring a little bit of joy and happiness to people that maybe they need, you know, at any time in life when life is hard. And, you know, ska can get kind of a bad rap for whatever reason, but regardless of what anybody thinks of ska, there is a reason for it. There's a purpose. And, yeah. And I know what that purpose is when I'm playing our shows, because I see it in those people's faces. I see it and I know it. I know it. And that's why I brought this band back. It was because I knew that there was a bigger purpose and a bigger meaning and a bigger reason for this. It wasn't just for me. Like, it wasn't just for my dad. It wasn't just to prove to myself that I could do it. It was because ultimately I knew that this world needed this music and needed to be able to have, like, people needed to be able to have a place to go where they could either remember the best years of their lives when they were going to shows when they were kids, or be able to forget their problems for, you know, an hour or two. And that's kind of what that means to me.
Thank you for listening to In Defense of Ska. To support the show, sign up for our Patreon. Intro and outro music by Slow Gherkin from the EP Lives. Additional music by Dan P. and the Bricks. Please rate and review the podcast and tell a friend. Follow at In Defense of Ska on social media. The book In Defense of Ska by Aaron Carnes is available from Clash Books. Order it online. Chris Reeves of SPI is our editor. This is your co-host, Adam Davis of Omnigon, leaving you by saying ska now more than ever.
Ska now more than ever. Ska now more than ever.
I'll have to say this week, we brought on Monique Powell, and this is probably one of the most important Patreon portions we've ever done in this podcast.
Absolutely. Why is that, Aaron?
Well, we established in the actual episode that she was behind ska now more than ever, but we ask her, we reveal to her that we have been using it, and we get her actual reaction of what she thinks about it. And that's all I'm going to say. You have to sign up to the Patreon to find that out. Yeah.
Yeah. Get over there. Get on that Patreon. Aaron needs to buy more dog food for his dog. You can hear, dog in the background.
I know. The dog's like, feed me, Patreon subscribers.
Dog food's not cheap. Aaron's got to, you know, feed that dog. So sign up for the Patreon.
As a parent of a dog.
As a fur baby parent.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, sign up to Patreon so my dog doesn't starve. Ska now more than ever.
Fluffy bread, classic burger buns, and so many carbs. Carb fear is real, but Hero Bread makes healthier versions of the carb-heavy favorites we love most. We're talking fewer calories, 0 to 2 grams net carbs, zero sugar, and seriously great taste. Plus, more of the dietary fiber and protein you want with no compromise. Don't skip out on your favorites. Just use Hero Bread. Get 10% off your order at hero.co with code HEROPOD at checkout.
We all have that friend who wakes up early to go get everyone McDonald's breakfast while the rest of us sleep in. This is your sign to thank them. And if you're that friend, this is us saying thank you.
Just a friendly reminder that right now, get any size iced coffee before 11 a.m. for just 99 cents. And a satisfying sausage McMuffin with egg is just $2.79. Price and participation may vary. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.